everybody. How we doing? Everybody awake? Yeah, you know it's daylight savings time when you just are looking for bed at 8 o'clock in the morning. So I went to lay down and I thought, I still have to go to work. I'm going to open in prayer. Father, I pray that you would open our eyes and our hearts and our minds this morning. I pray that you would enliven our hearts in such a way as to engage with you and to dance with you and to even yawn with you. And where those of us who come in fatigued and tired, Lord, I pray that we would just lean into you this morning. Those of us who are energized and ready to go, Father, I pray that we would dance. And those of us in between, Lord, I pray that we would bridge the gap, holding hands from those who come in tired and needing restoration, and to dance with those who come in spinning and twirling. So Lord, just help us to love you with everything we have this morning. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Let's stand and sing.
As your name,
that we would get a glimpse of what it is you have done for us, especially, Lord God, in relation to your incredible holiness and your glory and our desperate need for you. May we, Father, just catch a glimpse of that. May it transform our hearts and minds, our attitudes and our affections. And may we this morning be challenged to consider what it is you have done for us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. If you're a kid, go to the front and go to class. If you're not a kid, wake up, cross the aisle. I'm giving you 3 minutes to say hello to somebody and have a conversation. Give it out.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Mosaic. I see you all got the time correctly this morning. Thanks for showing up. My name is Heather. Thank you so much for joining us. If you are a guest with us here at Mosaic, take a look at the white pamphlet in the back of your pew, and you can get to know us a little bit better. There is also a connection card, and that is your tool to communicate with us. So if you have a question, comment, need information about classes, fill it out on that connection card, and once you do that, you can drop it into any one of our giving boxes. They're located out here in the narthex and out each one of these doorways into the main hall, so you can find it there and drop it in. And also, you can visit our Welcome Center downstairs in the Fellowship Hall if you have any questions and want to ask somebody in person. Some things that we have coming up. Women, there is an ongoing Bible study each week. It's on Wednesday mornings at 9:30 a.m. And they just finished the book of Galatians, and they're going to be starting a study on Ephesians. So if you want to join this Wednesday, March 14th at 9:30 a.m., that would be great. There's another Bible study coming up the first Thursday after Easter, and that's going to be on Thursdays, April 5th, starting on April 5th. And that's going to be on The Quest by Beth Moore. So both of these classes you can register online at mosaicmansfield.com or fill out one of those connection cards in the back of your pew. Drop it in a giving box and we'll get you registered there. Men, don't feel left out because we have a weekly Bible study for you as well. That's on Saturday mornings at 7:30 a.m. So all men are welcome. That is every single week except for holidays. And we want to give you a little bit more of a heads up this month about our third Wednesday breakfast and food pantry. It's not going to be this Wednesday, it's the following Wednesday, March 21st, and there are serving opportunities from 8 to 11 a.m. So join us for that if you're able. Then we are excited to announce for the first time Passion of the Christ on Good Friday. So that is March 30th at 7 p.m. This is an intense movie, but we feel it is worth seeing. So we're going to show that right here in the sanctuary. And we know this is not appropriate for kids. And they're also going to have snacks in the chapel. So you can bring your kids with you and we can all watch a movie together. And then also there's a sign up downstairs for the blood drive. If you want to sign up for that, you can do that downstairs at the Welcome Center. And then I am excited to introduce Sarah Goff with a special announcement.
We're going to be doing a jam night April 20th from 7 to 9 p.m. There's a sign up in the Fellowship Hall. There's two of them. One is if you can't make that, just put your info on there. And the second one is for that actual night. There's limited spots, so if you're a musician and interested to play a couple worship songs, then sign up and we'll see you then.
Good morning, everybody. How are we doing? All right, I've got to do something to wake up. So if I yell in the middle of the sermon, it's not because I'm hurt my foot. It could be that I hurt my foot, but it probably because I'm dozing. I don't know about you guys, but daylight savings time for me may be the very worst day of the entire year. And you know how long it lasts for me? Till November. I will tell you, I'm not even joking. I never, because I'm a morning guy. I love morning. I wake up 4:30, just bright-eyed and bushy-tailed and ready to roll until this happens. I don't even know if I have anything to say to you this morning, to be honest with you. This morning, I'm gonna be a little different than I was last night, I think. We've been in the study in Ephesians. We're in Ephesians 5, and we're talking about God's love, and we're getting to some choppy waters in terms of how that love is expressed. And I don't know where expected came from, so I'm going to have to recalibrate. Okay, let's do this. I'm going to pray, then we're going to read the scriptures, and we're going to see if God gets my head where it's supposed to be. Father, we thank you for the morning. And I pray, Lord, if anybody's visiting this morning, that they would be okay. And just open your word to us. What a wonderful thing it is that you have penned this letter to us as an expression of your affection and your love and your heart's desire, that we not only would know you, but that we can know that we're known by you. And in being known by you, Lord, you draw our hearts to you. And the confidence we have with you is that you know us by name, and you call us by name, and you desire to have this exchange with us. So, Father, may your word just penetrate this morning. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Do me a favor and turn to Luke chapter 7. My brain is literally fried, and so we're going to just read scripture. And we're going to, as the scripture unfolds, we'll get through what we need to get through today. So there's a reason I want to read this passage in Luke 7. Now we've actually been in Ephesians 5, but what it's done is it's led us back to the Gospels. And it's led us back into particular to see how Jesus loved and how he, because it says we're to love as we have been loved, as Jesus loved us and gave himself up for us. Well, it seems to me that the best way for us then to figure out how to love like Jesus loves is to go see how he loved. Doesn't that make the most sense? And so for whatever reason, as we've gone through this text, we've gone back and we've looked at the person of Jesus. How did he love? How did he love us? Well, this morning is a contrast. As we move further into Ephesians 5, what I want us to see is what Paul is contrasting. And it's really important for us to understand there's a contrast here. Because if you read it in the English, and you don't understand well who it is we are in Christ and how it is that God loves us, the contrast is lost on us and we can become confused in terms of what God actually thinks of us. Really, really important here. And so the story we're going to read is a matter of contrast, but it's a contrast of hearts and how Jesus responds to each heart. So let's look at this. We're going to start in verse 36, and we'll see how long we're here. All right, ready? So, you good? So we're in Luke 7, starting at verse 36. Just let me know when you're set by, I don't know, saying, hey, I'm ready. Okay, thumbs up, we're ready to go. And I almost dumped my water. So here we go. So now it says, one of the Pharisees. Now we have to stop here for a moment because we have to remember what a Pharisee was. Pharisee was a teacher of the law. They were leaders in the synagogue and the communities. They were the paragon of righteousness as far as the Jews were concerned. These were the keepers of the law, they were the holders of the law, the governors of the law, and the teachers of the law. And how they lived was supposed to be the example to the rest of the Jews. Unfortunately, what had happened was they lived in such a way from a legalistic standpoint and a tradition standpoint that they made all the Jews feel as though they could never live up to what the Pharisees were. And the Pharisees liked that. There's an arrogance about them and a us versus them about them. On top of that, the Pharisees did this. They antagonized Jesus. They were constantly infiltrating where he was in his teaching time to try to test him in front of the people. Part of this was to discredit him. Part of it was to trap him. Part of it was to try to prove that he was not who the people thought that he was. Part of it was jealousy. There's one portion of the gospel where it says that the Pharisees were jealous because Jesus was gaining more disciples than they were. So there's a lot of stuff going around. So when it says one of the Pharisees, that's all the stuff we have to have in our mind as we see the word Pharisee and the connection between the Pharisees and Jesus and what maybe was their intentions. And then watch how it unfolds. Ready? So here we go. Now one of the Pharisees invited Jesus. Now the next key term here as we get into the story is invited. We know what invited is, what an invitation is. But let's look at the word, but I want you to keep in mind the word invited. Now one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him. So he went to the Pharisee, it was Jesus, went to the Pharisee's house and he reclined at the table. Now this is important for us to know what that looks like also. We have to understand that the Jews ate at low tables and they would recline at the table. And they would recline on their left side. The reason for that is because the left side was the common hand and the mundane hand. You did everything you needed to do that was not clean with your left hand. And then you use your right hand for anything social or eating or anything like that. And so when they would recline at the table, they would recline on their left side with their feet back away from the table, and they would recline next to one another. And this is how they would have conversation with one another. I kind of like this. This is like having a picnic in your living room, watching a movie with some popcorn. Got a little pillow here underneath the pit, you know, to keep the pressure off the shoulder. I'm eating with my hand, I'm talking with my friends. This is how they would look. Now this is important to recognize, so when we get into the story, we understand what is transpiring. As Americans, this is not how we eat. So, we'll go again. So now, one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him. So he went to the Pharisee's house and he reclined at the table. Notice how abrupt all that is. He was invited to have dinner, he went to the Pharisee's house, he reclined at the table. When a woman who had lived a sinful life. Now the sinful life, this term sinful life, often meant, usually meant, sexual promiscuity, and in particular prostitution. And there are a couple clues as we go on that may answer the question as to what her profession was. But this idea of her having lived a sinful life was code, Jewish code for sexual promiscuity and or prostitution. So here we go. Now one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to dinner with him went to the Pharisee's house and he reclined at the table. When a woman who had lived a sinful life in that town learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house, she brought an alabaster jar of perfume. Now here's our clue to her profession. An alabaster jar of perfume was code for wealth. This is richness. This is an alabaster jar. This was expensive. In fact, we see in another place where somebody brings an alabaster jar of perfume to anoint Jesus, and it's worth a year's wages. So look what it says here. Now one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him, so he went to the Pharisee's house and he reclined at the table. When a woman who had lived a sinful life in that town learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house, she brought an alabaster jar of perfume, and as she stood behind him, stop. Now I want us to put ourselves here. We're at a Pharisee's house. How do you think Pharisees felt about sinful women? Can you imagine this woman recognizing that Jesus is where Jesus is, and she goes into the house? See, we read the story and we don't think about what is actually occurring because we just reread the story for what it is and try to learn the lesson we need to learn from it. But what we need to do is recognize exactly what was happening because it tells us the actual lesson. This is a woman who had lived a sinful life. This was known. A sinful life in that town. This was not a woman who was hidden. This is a woman where people knew what it is she was and what it is she did. And she heard that Jesus was in this home, the home of a Pharisee, and she would enter into the home. Take that into consideration for a moment. What did it take for this woman to go forward? What did it take for her to enter into this home? What did it take for her to bring what she brought? Remember, what we're doing here is we're looking at a contrast of hearts. Now, one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him, so he went to the Pharisee's house and reclined at the table. When a woman who had lived a sinful life in that town learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house, she brought an alabaster jar of perfume, and as she stood behind him at his feet weeping, stop there. She stood at his feet weeping. What could this be? Where was her heart? Who was this man? What was this circumstance? Why is she there? Why? Now, one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him, so he went to the Pharisee's house and reclined at the table. When a woman who had lived a sinful life in that town learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house, she brought an alabaster jar of perfume, and as she stood behind him at his feet weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears. Are any words exchanged? Is he proclaiming anything? Is he demanding anything? No, by his mere presence and what she had known about him and maybe seen him and maybe heard while she was in the town, she knew who this man was. She knew where her heart was. She knew what her need was, and she came. And she came in such a way as to boldly enter into a place that was like a lion's den for her. And she stood at the feet of Jesus, and she began to weep. And she wept in such a way that her tears flowed enough to wet his feet. See, it's really important for us to understand how the reclining, because for her to stand behind him and then wet his feet is a little confusing for us. And I don't want us even for a moment to lose sight of the story, trying to figure out, okay, well, how are they sitting? That she's sitting behind him, standing behind him, and no. He's reclined and he's looking back and she's at his feet and she's weeping and the tears are flowing and she's... This picture is enormous. And it's the expression of a convicted heart. But not just a convicted heart. Watch. Now, one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him, so he went to the Pharisee's house and reclined at the table. When a woman who had lived a sinful life in that town learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house, she brought an alabaster jar of perfume, and as she stood behind him at his feet weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears, and then she wiped them with her hair. See, it's hard for us to imagine how in the ancient times hair was considered, but it was the woman's glory, was her hair. And so for her to humiliate herself and to put herself at great risk to enter into a Pharisee's house, to kneel at the feet of this teacher, this man, who appears to be God, to weep, recognize her sin in such a way as to weep, to have her tears flow in such a way as to wash his feet, then to let loose her hair and to dry his feet with her hair. As she stood behind him at his feet weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears, and then she wiped them with her hair and kissed them and poured perfume on them. Verse 39. When the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, "If this man were a prophet, he would know who is touching him and what kind of woman she is, and that she is a sinner." Contrast of hearts. Contrast of hearts. Contrast of hearts. Jesus answered him. Now I love that. Because it says that the Pharisee said it to himself. Now, I don't know if he was one of those people who kind of, when they're thinking to themselves and talking to themselves, it comes out of their mouths, they don't even realize it comes out. You know, you ever been there, or you ever done that? Like, you're thinking about something, it just, you're just saying it inside your head, but you don't realize it's actually coming out, and the person next to you goes, what? And you go, oh, so I don't know if it was that guy. I don't know if it was Jesus knowing the man and the man's heart already, and so he would recognize what this man would be thinking without him having to say it. Or if this is God recognizing what's going on inside the man's head. I'm not sure which one it is. It could be all three. But this I know. Jesus answers him. Look what it says. It says, now when the Pharisee had invited him and saw this, he said to himself, if this man were a prophet, he would know who is touching him and what kind of woman she is, that she is a sinner. Jesus answered him, Simon, I have something to tell you. Tell me, teacher, he said. Two men owed money to a certain moneylender. One owed him 500 denarii and the other 50. Neither of them had the money to pay him back, so he canceled the debts of both. Now, which of them will love him more? Simon replied, I suppose the one with the bigger debt canceled. You have judged correctly, Jesus said. See, the Pharisees indicted himself in expressing the condition of his heart. When he would label the woman a sinner and not recognize his own sin, he would see the woman's desperate need but would not see his own. When he would judge the woman for what she was but would not receive judgment for his own self. And the condition of the heart then determines how we treat the one who has loved us. The condition of our own heart will determine how we treat the one who has loved us and the degree to which we have been loved, or at least willing, listen, to receive that love. Watch. Verse 44. So Jesus turned toward the woman and said to Simon, do you see this woman? I came into your house and you did not give me water for my feet. Stop. This is a really important moment because we need to understand what it is to have water for your feet, because we don't do this in America. You know, it would be kind of like the equivalent of somebody having slippers for our feet when they come in, right? Or for to be able to have something to wipe the feet and somewhere to put the shoes and somewhere, you know, because the guest does not want to in any way besmirch the home. But in this particular case, this is how it works. When you would come into when you were the guest of someone's home, they would offer you water for you to wash your feet. And to offer you water to wash your own feet was actually the mark of the poor, because they couldn't afford servants. And so it was a common courtesy, a common custom, even among the poor, that at the very least, when you have a guest come into the home, you would offer them water to wash their own feet and a towel with which to dry them off. Look what it says. Do you see this woman? I came into your house. You did not give me any water for my feet, but she has wet my feet with her tears and wipe them with her hair. But see, this, it gets worse for the Pharisee. See, the common custom even among the poor was to give them water and a towel to wash their own feet. But you know what the common custom for the wealthy was? To make sure that a servant met you at the door and washed your feet and wiped them with a towel. You know one of the marks of the Pharisees? Was they were wealthy. So what Jesus is saying is, you didn't even give me the common courtesy of the poor as to give me water for my feet, let alone have your servant wash my feet. That's why it's so important when we see the beginning of the story, we see how abrupt it is. Came into the house, reclined at the table. There was no courtesy, there was no welcome, there was no honor or respect. Well, how do we know that? Because we keep going, watch. Again, contrast of hearts. Contrast of hearts. Do you see this woman? I came into your house. You did not give me any water for my feet, but she wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You did not give me a kiss. A kiss? Well, what does that mean? A welcome, a warm welcome to a friend. A warm welcome to somebody who you respect and who you want to endear yourself to. You would welcome them into your home with a kiss. I was in Ukraine. You know what they warned me about before I went to Ukraine? I was going to get kissed. You know who I was going to get kissed by? Men. You know where they were going to kiss me? On the lips. You know what I said to myself when I heard that? I don't think so. I don't think so. So I get to Ukraine, and one of the things they said to me, they said, listen, when they kiss you on the lips, receive it. And I'm like, see, even in my family, we're not lip kissers. We're cheek kissers, right? My grandpa was a lip kisser, and that was okay. It was my grandpa, and I was a kid. But in my family, we're cheek kissers. In the Italians, we kiss on the cheek. This lip kissing thing, I tend to reserve that for one person. So here I am in Ukraine, and they come to greet me, and they grab me by the shoulders, and I get this mustache, bang, right under my lip. That's how they greet you. They said in Romans, it says, greet each other with a holy kiss. Bing, there it is. Blam. Oh. Dunk you very much. And don't wipe it off. Now I've completely lost track of what I was doing. Oh. So here's the deal. What Jesus is saying is, listen, I came into your home and you didn't give me the common courtesy of the poor is to give me water and a towel, let alone reflect your wealth by having a servant come and wash my feet. There was no common courtesy. There was no sense of friendship and this idea of endearment by giving me a kiss when I would enter in. She has not stopped kissing my feet since I've been here. She's shown me respect and endearment and affection and care. It gets even worse. Verse 46. You did not put oil on my head. This was the act of honor. That you're not just a guest whose feet I would have washed. You're not just a guest and a friend who I would greet with a kiss. You are an honored guest that I would anoint your head with oil. I see you as esteemed and respectable. And therefore, I want you to know what I think of you. And it says, she has not stopped putting perfume on my feet. Bless you. This is a contrast of hearts. And it's one we, as God's children, need to grasp. We do. And Jesus explains it. Jesus turned to the woman and said to Simon, do you see this woman? I came into your house and you did not give me any water for my feet, but she wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You did not give me a kiss, but this woman from the time I entered has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not put oil on my head, but she has poured perfume on my feet. She has seen who he is and has treated him accordingly. The Pharisee did not, and therefore would not. Verse 47. Therefore, I tell you, her many sins are forgiven. Now again, in the English, this is rendered in a funny way, and so it could be easily misunderstood. In the original language, it is shed a little differently and correctly. Her sins are not forgiven because she loved him the way she loved him. She loved him the way she loved him because her sins had been forgiven. We need to recognize she had already known who he was when she got there, and she came there to honor him. She had probably heard him teach and experienced watching him with the crowds and listened as he and watched as he dignified people just like her. This is a woman who lived a sinful life, who was known throughout the town for having done so. This is a woman who dared walk into a Pharisee's house. The deed was already done. She's now responding to him because she knew him and knew that she was known by him. And being known by him was not condemned, but was redeemed. And so what Jesus is saying to the Pharisee is this: therefore I tell you, her many sins have been forgiven, for she loved much. I can tell the degree of forgiveness that she has received. I can tell that she knew the degree of her sin and her need, not by anything else but how she has loved me in response. That having been forgiven as she has been forgiven, she cannot help now but honor me. Where's your honor? Where is the water, the kiss, and the oil? Where is the heart that recognizes its own sin and desperate need for redemption? How is it that we respond to the God who calls us by name and knows us? How do we respond? Have we been forgiven much? Look what it goes on to say. Therefore, I tell you, her many sins have been forgiven, for she loved much. But he who has been forgiven little does what? Loves little. Then Jesus said to her, your sins are forgiven. The other guests began to say among themselves, who is this that even forgives sins? And Jesus said to the woman, your faith has saved you. Not how you loved me. Your faith has saved you. And because your faith has saved you, now you know how to love me, because now you have been loved. That's 1 John. Your faith has saved you. Look what it says next. Now go in peace. Go with peace between me and you, and you and mankind, and you and your own heart. Your behavior has reflected what it is you have received. See, now when we go to Ephesians 5, that's the question we need to ask ourselves. Do I recognize just how awesome this God is? Do I recognize just how deep my sin was? Do I recognize that what he did for me was so grand and so crazy and so ridiculous and so awful that my only response can be a life devoted back to him? With common courtesy, with friendship and honor. Water, kiss, and oil. Turn to Ephesians 5. Whew. Now, with this as the backdrop, I don't know how much I have to teach in Ephesians 5. Because to a large degree, what we just saw is what Ephesians 5 teaches. Well, this is what I want us to remember. The chapters 1 through 3, or even the first half of 4 in Ephesians, Paul is doing something. Paul is saying, this is who God is, and this is what God has done, and you've been the recipient of that thing, and he has empowered you and enabled you and made you his child, and he's given you everything you need for life and godliness, and now he's asked you to join him in this. And what I want you to know more than anything, chapters 1 through 3, is that you are saved, and this God loves you, and you are now his children. And he repeats it over and over and over again to embed deeply in our souls that truth. That is teaching of salvation. And it is a reminder of who we are. And when it says in chapter 4, the hinge verse of chapter 4, it says, chapter 3, speak the truth in love. What he's saying is this: all these truths that I've just reminded you of, now you remind one another of the truth of who God is and who you are to God and how it is he's called you. That's speaking the truth in love. It has nothing to do with falsehoods. It has to do with a constant encouragement and reminder and exhortation that we never are discouraged or forget who it is and whose it is we are. Boom! Do it. Okay, so from chapter 4 on, he's talking about righteousness. Now, this is what I need to do. Come here, my friend. Randy, come here if you would. Adam, come here if you would, please. Okay, we're going to be as quick as we can be because there's about 2 more hours of stuff to do. So, and we have about 8 minutes to do it in. Okay, so these guys obviously are very pretty. The one in the middle is the prettiest. Okay. That's why God took his hair from him. Same with me. I just want you to bask in the glory of our bald heads for a moment and just take that time. Okay, so here's the deal. This is what I want to do. This is the idea of redemption. You're Jesus because you have a beard. Oh, you have a beard too. Okay, you're God because you're old. Okay, all right. I'll let you be Jesus. Okay, so, and you're sinful. Okay, so here's the deal. What it is Paul is teaching about salvation and the righteousness we gain when we have salvation. Because when we are saved, we are now righteous. It says in Ephesians 1, when he begins to describe salvation, who we are to God in Christ, he says that the Father, in essence, has chosen you to be holy and blameless in his sight. Don't roll over that too quickly. The Father, God, has chosen to see us as holy and blameless in his sight. The Father has chosen to see us as holy and blameless in his sight. Excuse me, I have to kiss this guy. Good to see you. How you doing? Think about that for a minute. Because this is what I want us to recognize. At salvation, what Jesus did was something really, really profound. Before salvation, God being holy, man being sinful, their characters are completely and utterly different, diametrically opposed. God is about himself and his glory, and he has created us to enjoy his glory and to enjoy his presence. He has made us to enjoy this wonderful relationship with the very creator of the universe, and to be his children, to be embraced by him. But sin has separated us in the context of that relationship, and it's made us unholy. He's righteous, he's unrighteous. And so they cannot coexist, they can't be together. And so there's this great chasm in between them where sin separates them. And there's nothing we can do to get over here. No works can change the nature of who we are. God, though, wants so badly to have a relationship with us that this is what he says. He says, listen, I know there's nothing they can do, but there's something I can do. And so he sends his son to live a perfect life on earth, to fulfill everything that it is that man could not fulfill. And in doing so, made himself a perfect sacrifice for this, to pay the price for the sin and the sinfulness of man, to take upon himself the very wrath that right now sits on man and the justice that must be executed based on that wrath and that sin, that someone would receive it on our behalf as to give us now life in Christ, to allow us to bridge this gap. So this is what's happening. As sinful man stands before God, God's wrath is on him because God, holiness and sin cannot coexist. And God hates sin because sin has destroyed his world and brought death to those he loves. Jesus came then, it says this. This is what it says in the scriptures. It says that Jesus, he who knew no sin, became sin for us. So what happened was Jesus takes upon himself the sins of men and therefore justly takes the wrath of God upon himself and the punishment, the payment that was necessary to satisfy God's desire for holiness. Jesus took it upon himself. The scripture says that he who knew no sin became sin for me so that he would now be my righteousness. So now, prior to knowing Jesus, even though Jesus has done this work, prior to knowing Jesus, his wrath is still on him because he has sinned. But once he recognizes what it is that Jesus has done and will receive from Jesus life in him, Jesus' righteousness now covers him. So that when the Father looks here, all he sees is Jesus, holy and blameless in his sight. And that is true for every one of us who surrenders our lives to Christ in faith, recognizing his person and his work and what he has done on our behalf as to bridge the gap between us and a holy Father, forgiving our sin, cleansing us, and making us new creatures in Christ to restore us to the relationship that God had created for us in the beginning that is now eternal. Isn't that beautiful? If you're taking notes, put Romans chapter 3 right here. The entirety of Romans chapter 3 is in that little demonstration. And this is all done by grace, a free gift for us. So, this is salvation. And he is now righteous, not based on anything he has done, but on what Jesus has done. So when the Father looks here, all he sees is the righteousness of Christ over him. And we go, well, that's great as long as he's walking close, right? Nope. Get away. What happens if he's walking in sin? What do you see, God? Jesus. Still the righteousness of Christ. Still holy and blameless. And we're going, well, what's it matter then? What did it matter to the woman and the Pharisee in regard to righteousness and the recognition of all that God had done? And how did the woman respond? She could not respond that way. Neither can we not respond that way. So the desire then, this whole idea now, to be taught in righteousness is this. To be taught in righteousness, the first of all, recognize that he is righteous, and he is what allows us to be seen as holy and blameless. That when my life in Christ is working like a well-oiled machine, what it is I've been effective and productive in my relationship with him. And so, although the Father sees me through the lens of Christ, the proximity of my life with Jesus as I walk in obedience and with the Spirit is effective and productive, and there's joy and there's peace and there's confidence in my salvation. There's confidence in who I am in Christ, and I glow. But then there are times when I sin, and I choose to sin, and I remain in sin, and I walk distance from Jesus. The Father still sees me through the lens of Christ, so I'm still holy and blameless. The Father never sees my sin, but Jesus feels my sin, as does the Spirit. It says that we can grieve the Spirit of God with whom we've been sealed. That grief is brought because there's this desire for a loving, close relationship that's effective and productive. And when we sin and remain in sin, we grieve our Father through Christ Jesus by the Spirit. The Father still sees us as being holy and blameless, but we're now ineffective, and we begin to doubt, and we begin to shudder, and we begin to wonder what it is this is all about. And when we come to our senses, we come back and we repent and we ask forgiveness and we walk with Jesus. This is teaching on righteousness. This is how we live out the righteousness that is in us. That righteousness that we have in Christ Jesus is now lived through our lives. Listen. Paul says it over and over again in Ephesians, to the praise of his glory. As we recognize more and more deeply just what it is that God has done for us, and we now enter into the room and kneel at his feet and thank him for all that he's done. Do you see this? So the second half of Ephesians is to teach us how to live the life that we have gained in the first half of Ephesians. It's to show us how to live in such a way as to bring glory to God and to magnify who he is, so that people will see him in us and will be effective and productive, not only in the confidence we have in our relationship with him, but how it is we reflect him to a dying world. Isn't that crazy? All right, sit. Oh man, I'm glad we have a long time left. Whew. Is anybody else sweating? I am sweating to beat the band. Okay, so here we go. Go to Ephesians chapter 5. And now we're going to see the contrast and why it's so important for us to see the contrast. I need a sip of water. All right, so we're going to start at verse 1. My encouragement to you is to go back and read from 4:17 on when you go home today. But we're going to start at 5:1, okay? So it says now, be imitators of Christ. Now stop, go back to 4:1. I want us to see something. Paul again has told us, this is what God has done. This is who we are in him. This is the glory that we now carry. And we have been saved, and we walk to the praise of his glory. Look at verse 1, it says, as a prisoner for the Lord, then I urge you now to live a life worthy of that call. Worthy of the call you have received. Live a life that's worthy. In other words, allow the righteousness that's in you, exercise it so that it begins to show on the outside. So we go to chapter 5, verse 1. It says, now be imitators of God. As dearly loved children, and live a life of love. Just as Christ loved us and did what? Gave himself up as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. That's the demonstration we just did. He did this for us. The woman knew that. That's what gave her the strength and the courage to walk into the lion's den and in a completely uninhibited manner say, oh my God, thank you. And express to him courtesy and camaraderie and honor. We are of the same spirit that woman is. We have been forgiven like she has. Our sins were many, and he took them upon himself. It is ours now in great thanksgiving to honor him, to walk beside him, to give him our very best. That's why that alabaster jar is so important to understand. This was her finest. But among you now, now he's talking about righteousness. You ready for this? He's already talked to us about speech. If we start at 4:17, he talks about don't lie to each other anymore. Tell the truth. Don't allow your anger to just blow up. Be patient. Don't, if you're stealing, don't steal anymore. Get a job. Take care of yourself. And earn enough to give to other people. Don't let any crappy stuff come out of your mouth. Instead, only that which is good for building others up. And when you do that, understand you're affecting everybody around you. Now, love as you've been loved. So where does he go? He goes right to sexual sin. Why does he go to sexual sin? Because that's what we equate as love. And it is love. But when it's in the wrong context, it's perverted. It's twisted. It's misrepresenting the Father. And so look what he says. We're to love as Christ loved, offering ourselves as he offered himself as a sacrifice to God. But among you now, there must not even be a hint of sexual immorality or any kind of impurity or any kind of greed, because these are improper for God's holy people. This is not how those who are redeemed by Christ ought to live. Why did he have to say this? Because they were in a culture that was pervasive in regard to sexuality. They had grown up, generations of Ephesians and Gentiles had grown up, and pagans had grown up using not only sexuality any way they wanted to, but as part of the religious practices. And so the sexuality for them, they didn't understand its importance and its sacredness and its, how God valued it. They didn't even know it was sin. And so he's saying, no, listen, this can't be. This can't be. So it says, but among you there must not even be a hint of sexual immorality or any kind of impurity or of greed, because these are improper for God's holy people. Nor should there be obscenity or foolish talk or coarse joking. Don't even joke about these things, because it diminishes its value in your eyes. It causes you to think about it in ways that are inappropriate. It may tempt you to go directions you ought not go. It mortifies those who would be modest. Look what it goes on to say. Nor should there be any obscenity or foolish talk or coarse joking, which is out of place, but rather thanksgiving. Remember who you are. Remember whose you are. Remember all of your sin, and remember how it was redeemed, and remember how you've been forgiven, and remember the one who's forgiven you, and now act accordingly. Now it gets really tough. Look at verse 5. For of this you can be sure, no immoral, impure, or greedy person, such a man as an idolater, has any inheritance in the kingdom of God, Christ and God. And what is he saying here? Is he saying that a believer who behaves this way is now lost his salvation? No. What he's saying is anyone who continues in this mode of life habitually and consistently and without any remorse, but in fact even justifying it, there's evidence to wonder whether he's a Christian at all. Period. And so what he's saying is, listen to me. You have it in you to live this pure life, and we serve one who deserves us to live a pure life. And we are an example and a testimony to those who need us to live a pure life. Therefore, live a pure life. And do this over time. Recognize, I know you're just realizing this now, you're just getting to know this now, but you're going to realize it more and more. And as you walk with Christ, as you grow with Christ, as you take into consideration who you are in Christ, and the Holy Spirit moves you forward, and you learn more and more of the truth, as you know more, you will become more adept at recognizing what sin looks like and leaving it behind. So right now, he's teaching to righteousness. He's saying, this is what righteousness looks like. Now work toward it. Now go to Hebrews chapter 5, if you would. There are two really important things we need to see here. Go to verse 11. Hebrews 5:11. This is going to be teaching to righteousness, the difference between teaching to salvation and righteousness. Watch this. You ready? So we're in Hebrews. It's near the end of the New Testament. If you got to James, you went too far. Ready? Chapter 5, verse 11. We good? Here we go. We have much to say about this, but it is hard to explain because you're what? You're slow to learn. In fact, though, by this time you ought to be teachers. You've been a believer long enough so that you should know enough that you should be teaching others. In fact, though, by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you the elementary truths of God's word all over again. You need milk, not solid food. Anyone who lives on milk, being still an infant, is not acquainted with the teaching about what? Righteousness. They've been made righteous, they have a salvation, but they have neglected their spiritual growth in such a way that they need to be constantly reminded of that truth, because in their immaturity, they quake and doubt. That's the distance that happens between Jesus and the believer, still seen as holy and blameless by the Father through the lens of Christ, but as distanced from effective and productive relationship with Jesus because they've not trained themselves. Look what it goes on to say now. You need milk, not solid food. Verse 13, anyone who lives on milk, being still an infant, is not acquainted with the teaching about righteousness, but solid food is for the whom? For the mature, the maturing, who by what? Constant use have trained themselves to distinguish good from evil, or right behavior from sinful behavior. That is what Paul is going into in chapter 5. He is saying to these people, I've reminded you now of who you are. I've reminded you now of whose you are. I've reminded you of everything that he's done for you. I've reminded you of how he is now, that he is in you and calls you to live both a life that reflects his glory and that loves the way to love others as you've been loved. Now, this is how you do it. Not in sexual immorality, taking advantage of one another and going about behaving in such a manner, but instead living in purity, recognizing what it is that God values. We'll get deeper into that soon. But there's something else I want us to see. Band, go ahead and get in place if you would. Go back to Ephesians, if you would. Ephesians 5. Go down to verse 4. Ready? Now should there be obscenity, foolish talk, or coarse joking, which are out of place, but rather thanksgiving. For of this you can be sure, that no immoral, impure, or greedy person, such a man is an idolater, such a person has placed a god in front of God, or has looked away from God to their own god, okay, has any inheritance in the kingdom. Anyone who has given their heart's affection to another god is not a child of God. They're an idolater. Verse 6. Let no one deceive you with empty words. What does that mean? Don't let anyone help you justify this behavior. Don't let anyone tell you that this is okay. Don't let anyone say that it is not important that we live righteous lives. Don't believe those things. Let no one deceive you with empty words. For because of such things, God's what? God's wrath comes on those. What does that mean? God's wrath is not on the child of God. We just saw that. God's wrath is on sin. And for anyone who harbors sin in their heart, they are still under God's wrath. Christ Jesus took our wrath. He took the punishment we deserve. When we receive him in faith, what we have said is, Lord, thank you for taking the punishment that I deserve. Thank you for forgiving me and giving me your righteousness. Our hearts now need to reflect the woman at his feet. Those of us who harbor sin and refuse what Christ Jesus has offered will continue in the manner in which we've gone, and God's wrath on us. This is the man who refused the water, the kiss, and the oil, whose heart did not recognize his sinfulness and his need for redemption. God's wrath comes because sin has destroyed his creation. And it has brought death. And God hates sin. His wrath is not for those who are his children. There's discipline, but not wrath. His wrath is stored up for those who would be, who would remain idolaters and who would worship sin. And this is the contrast of hearts. Let's stand and sing. Remind us of the righteousness we have received in Christ Jesus, and that you see us as pure and holy and blameless in your sight. But Lord, also may we be compelled based on what it is you have done and how it is we've been forgiven and the depth of that forgiveness to love you in response, to bring water and a kiss and an oil of honor. And may our lives begin to not only be righteous in the sense that you have made us righteous before you, but now we begin to live in righteousness as we live by the truth and by the leading of your Spirit. And may we recognize that the wrestling match we have in our heart with temptation is evidence of your Holy Spirit. That though we fall, Lord God, you are there and your grace is abundant and you forgive us. And may we not then look at those who do not struggle with temptation, because for them it is the things that they do is the natural expression of who they are. May we not hold them in contempt, but may we love them and reveal your glory and your forgiveness and your intentions for them, and share with them the righteousness that we have received by grace and the forgiveness we have received through Christ, that they may seek it also. May we be a light in a dark place because we have been forgiven much. May we love much. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Give somebody a hug. See you next week.